Item on our agenda is a grant of location utility hearing for Eversource. Hello.
Good evening. My name is Molly Carroll, and I'm here on behalf of the Eversource Company. And the first one is a petition. And the petition is on Chelmsford Road. It's northeasterly side, approximately 955 feet northwest of that. It's to relocate code 287/9 and to install an air. Also on Chelmsford Road, it's southeasterly from code 287/9, approximately 955 feet northwest, a distance of about 23 feet of conduit. This is to provide a new electric service to a residential development.
Okay. Are there comments or questions? This is a new development off of Chelmsford Road.
Do you happen to know the number of units on Isabella Lane?
Yes, it's going to be 4 new homes.
And I see Department of Public Works just included in their information to us, just a note asking that you be careful not to block the site distance. I don't know, I'm not sure exactly how you would necessarily accomplish that, but I guess the point would be to have somebody be talking to the DPW about, you know.
Yes, we usually get a street opening permit, but then the street opening, the town has stipulations.
Yes, okay. Any other questions or comments from anyone? Are there any questions or comments from the public? Seeing none, I will ask for a motion to close the hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded to close the public hearing. All those in favor say aye.
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 Those abstained, 500. Motion on the request for grant of location.
Move the selectmen grant, excuse me, grant location on Pine Hill Road northerly from pole number 75/13, approximately 20 feet southeast of Doris Road, a distance of about.
No, that's the next one.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Deja vu.
Oh, they just got switched. Take it back. That's why you were asking about Isabella Lane. Excellent. All right, I move that the selectmen grant the petition of Eversource for conduit Chelmsford Road southeasterly from pole number 287/9, approximately 950 feet northwest of North Road, a distance of about 23 feet of conduit.
Second.
subject to a street opening permit and a trench permit.
Still second.
Thank you.
Moved and seconded to approve the petition. Those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, abstained, 500.
Excuse me.
Okay. Second is a, I think I did not call to open the hearing. Second is a grant of location for Irene Road. So a motion to open the public hearing.
Mr. Chairman, do we have to wait?
Nope. Well.
Thank you.
Okay.
I mean.
You're right. We should. So we have 5 minutes. I'm sorry. we're speedy, but unfortunately now we're ahead of our schedule by 5 minutes.
We could 2 minutes.
We could do
caucus.
Minutes. We could do the call of the caucus.
And it's a good one.
Item 1682.
Did we change the date?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We did. The new proposed date for the Citizens Caucus for 2016. January 12th with a storm postponement date of January 13th.
Move that the selectmen schedule the annual Citizens Caucus for Tuesday, January 12th, 2016 at 7 p.m. with a snow date of January 13th, 2016.
Second.
Moved and seconded to call the caucus. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, abstained, 500.
Is it my turn to do it?
Your turn.
I think so. Make sure to be there.
I guess so.
And we have a 268A, Section 20B exemption. Item 1683 for Michael Sargent.
Oh, yeah, I can do that. Move that the selectmen grant a waiver under Mass General Laws, Chapter 268A, Section 20B of Michael Sargent.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, abstained, 500. Thank you for your patience. This will shorten the other end of our meeting. We also have an application for a special event temporary sign. Any questions about this one?
So, Mr. Chair,
yes.
In this particular case, the Boy Scout Troop 114 is asking for signs to be installed both on October 27th for 1 week and then again on November 12th for 1 week. And since technically it's the same event, we thought it should come before the Board of Selectmen, because normally the Selectmen can do, have granted the town manager authority to do 7 days for one event.
Last year we approved this approach. I can't personally see a reason not to approve it this year.
So are they switching the location? The two sides.
I think one was up at Mudge Way, and then the second time was down at DPW.
Yeah, so they're switching location. So it's 1 week at each location. I'll make a motion that we approve the application for a special event temporary sign for the Boy Scout Troop 114.
Second.
And moved and seconded to approve the Boy Scouts' request for temporary signs. So all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, abstained, 500. And we are still quicker than we think we can be. Well, I think we're going to go ahead with the next scheduled hearing.
Move that Selectman open the hearing on the proposal from Eversource regarding Pine Hill Road and Irene Road.
Second.
Moved and seconded to open the public hearing. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, abstained, 500. Thank you. Oh, no, go ahead.
Nope.
Sorry. Now we're finally open.
Again, my name is Maureen Carroll. I'm here on behalf of the Eversource Company, and I'm here at a petition for Pine Hill Road. It's northerly from pole 75/13, approximately 20 feet southeast of Doris Road. It's a distance of about 12 feet of conduit. This is to provide electric service to new four-lot residential development.
So is this coming down off of an existing pole and then going
yes.
into the ground, into the roadway, the new roadway that's been built?
It's actually built on, it's coming from the existing pole. It'll be off on the sidewalk side. It will not be in the street.
Oh, right.
It's on the same side of the residential development.
Yeah. Okay. Questions or comments? No? Okay. Are there any questions or comments from the public? None.
Move that the hearing be closed.
Second.
Moved and seconded to close the public hearing. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, abstain, 500. Thank you. All right. Is there a motion on the?
I'll move to approve the petition of the NSTAR Electric Company doing business as Eversource Energy for location for conduits and manholes at Pine Hill Road, northerly from pole number 75-13, approximately 20 feet southeast of Doris Road, a distance of about 12 feet of conduit.
Okay. Subject to a street opening and trench.
Subject to receiving a street opening permit and a trench permit.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, abstained, 500. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Well, we're still ahead of schedule.
I should say so.
Mr. Chair, I don't know, you may want to consider the bond issuance. I know the finance director's here waiting for that.
Sure.
Unless he plans to stay for the whole meeting, I'm not sure.
What's this one?
Are you sure he doesn't need time to prepare?
Didn't I just do that?
So this is the bond issuance approval, and including good news about our reaffirmed AAA rating.
That's correct, Mr. Chairman.
Great.
Chairman, I'm here to present to you the results of the bond issuance that we did last week, the affirmation of our AAA rating, and just to answer any questions that you might have. The bond sale was a total of $5,060,000. It represents eight projects, the biggest being the street sewer forest sewer main for $3,129,000. The average coupon rate that we received is 2.9%, but when you take into consideration the premium we received of $198,070.05, the net interest cost is 2.45%. The premium that we receive as per Mass General Law will be applied to the general fund as general fund revenue in accordance with Mass General Law. And tonight you have a series of paperwork that you need to sign with regards to the bonds, and if you have any questions, I'll certainly can answer.
Yes.
Victor, the money goes into the general fund for this fiscal year.
That's correct.
Does that mean that the Finance Committee is likely to want to possibly allocate it to rainy day funds or OPEB or something like that?
So the money would go into the general fund and it just closes to free cash, so it would be considered free cash.
So it just sits in free cash?
Right, well, yes, until it
until next annual town meeting.
Exactly.
Okay.
There's a proposed vote behind the introductory amendment.
Yes.
One of you.
You have to read it?
Yes, unfortunately.
That's all right. Good practice.
Starts with
vote. Yep. Ready?
Yep.
Voted that the sale of the $5,060,000 general obligation municipal purpose loan of 2015 bonds to the town, dated October 29, 2015, the bonds, to Robert W. Baird and Company, Inc., at the price of $5,258,070.05 and accrued interest, if any, is hereby approved and confirmed. The bond shall be payable on October 15th of the year and in the principal amounts and bear interest at the respective rates as follows. 2016, $330,000, 3%. 2017, $300,000, 2%. 2018, $300,000, 3%. 2019, $295,000, 2%. 2020, $295,000, 2%. 2021, $290,000, 3%. 2022, $290,000, 3%. 2023, $285,000, 3%. 2024, $285,000, 3%. 2025, $280,000, 3%. 2030, $710,000, 2.5%. 2035, $700,000, 3%. 2040, $700,000, 3.2%. Further voted that the bonds maturing on October 15th in each year of the years 2030, 2035, and 2040, each a term bond, shall be subject to mandatory redemption or mature as follows. Term bond due October 15, 2030, 2026, $145,000, 2027, $145,000, 2028, $140,000, 2029, $140,000, 2030, final maturity, $140,000. Term bond due October 15, 2035. 2031, $140,000, 2032, $140,000, 2033, $140,000, 2034, $140,000, 2035, final maturity, $140,000. Term bond due October 15, 2040, 2036, $140,000, 2037, $140,000, 2038, $140,000, 2039, $140,000, 2040, final maturity, $140,000. Further voted that in connection with the marketing and sale of the bonds, the preparation and distribution of a notice of sale and preliminary official statement dated September 29, 2015, as revised October 7, 2015, and a final official statement dated October 14, 2015, the official statement. Each in such form as may be approved by the town treasurer, being hereby ratified, confirmed, approved, and adopted. Further voted that the bond shall be subject to redemption at the option of the town upon such terms and conditions as are set forth in the official statement. Further voted that the town treasurer and the selectmen be and are hereby are authorized to execute and deliver a continuing disclosure undertaking in compliance with Securities and Exchange Commission Rule 15C2-12 in such form as may be approved by bond counsel to the town, which undertaking shall be incorporated by reference in the bonds for the benefit of the holders of the bonds from time to time. Further voted that we authorize and direct the treasurer to review and update the town's post-issuance federal tax compliance procedures with such changes that the treasurer's and bond counsel, as a treasurer and bond counsel deem sufficient, if any, in order to monitor and maintain the tax exempt status of the bonds. Further voted that each member of the selectmen, the town clerk, and the town treasurer be and hereby are authorized to take any and all such actions and execute and deliver such certificates, receipts, or other documents as may be determined by them or any of them to be necessary or convenient to carry into effect the provisions of the foregoing votes.
Second.
Everybody get that?
It's moved and seconded. Any further discussion, questions? Anyone would like any portion of that reread? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, abstain, 500.
Are these bond candidates for that 20% deal?
The sewer bonds next year will be.
Next year.
Yes.
Thank you. All right.
This is when I organize my own things to not get in the way of the new things.
All right. We have an appointment interview. We are close enough to time, and appreciate your patience there. We have a candidate here for the Cultural Council. Ms. Dennis, want to come up? Good evening. So, the member who is the liaison to the Cultural Council will describe the council, and then we'll ask you why you're interested, and then we'll see if there are questions from the members. There are two vacancies, and there are three candidates. So we'll see where we go with that. So, and Cultural Council.
So I'm the liaison. Mm-hmm. I'll introduce the council as a liaison, and then I will recuse myself from further comments and questions. Mm-hmm. So the purpose of the Cultural Council is to support local public projects through the re-granting of the annual allocation from the Massachusetts Cultural Council. And the projects should promote access to education, diversity, and excellence in the arts and sciences and humanity. The focus of the council is to do a few things. Most importantly, it's solicit community input, so we get a number of grants being applied for. Establish priorities for the grant applications, communicate back with the public, and of course, report back to the Massachusetts Cultural Council in the end. And just as a note, they are in the middle of the grant review process now, and there is a meeting on Wednesday at 7 o'clock to review the grants that are pending. So that's the council in a nutshell.
Thank you. So why don't you tell us a little about why you're interested in being on the Cultural Council?
Well, I've been interested. I like what they do. They're doing a lot more now. I've been interested in this position for a while, but I haven't had the time. I have a little more time now, and I'd like to get involved. They have very little money. I think it's under $5,000. But they do so much for so many different organizations in town. The COA being one. Social club, I can name all the arts, the scouts. And they had a workshop on the 15th of October on how to write grants, which was very informative. And I've been in touch with the chairman. I've asked her different questions, and we've been back and forth with an email. And they're now in the heavy season of having people apply for the grants. They do not meet that often. So they are meeting, very informative, and I like what they do. kind of like how they help the local organizations, and they put a lot of thought and effort into it, and I'd like to be involved with it.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you. Are there questions from the members?
I think I asked this of the last applicants, which was, is there anything that you see among the grants that where you feel as though there's there's something underserved or a particular grant that you think was exemplary or anything that pops out at you as, you know, something that you'd like to encourage or something that you see that has not been supported that you'd like to support?
No, in fact, I'm amazed at how many they do support with so little money. I haven't seen anything that they've overlooked. They put a lot of effort into it. And nothing really that gets me as needing work with, needed help with.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Well, you certainly are very familiar with all your other volunteer activities, well, all the service you've...
Getting bored?
All right. I think it goes without saying, of course, we appreciate that you're interested in volunteering additionally and some more. We very much appreciate that. I will just go through a quick rundown of things that we just alert all candidates in case you're appointed. You are probably well aware of all these things, but if you were appointed, you would receive, again, a copy of the conflict of interest law. Not sure exactly where those conflicts might be, but if you ever had any question about whether or not you were facing some kind of a conflict of interest in your role as a member of the Cultural Council, you could always call town manager's office and ask questions, and if it were something particularly difficult, we always have access to the town's attorneys, and they can also help you. You would also get a copy of the ethics law, and the open meeting law, excuse me. Probably the thing to remember most about the open meeting law has to do with limitations on using email to converse amongst the members. Again, you're probably very familiar with this, but the work of any of our committees, any publicly appointed committee, cannot be done through email. You can schedule, you can send around things you think are interesting that others would read, but you can't engage in conversations between members of the public bodies like these on email, because you're in effect doing that outside of the public meeting requirements for the public to be able to see that. The other reminder is just that the town has long established rules for civil discourse. Again, maybe not particularly likely in cultural council kinds of activities, but from time to time, the public comes to the meetings of the various boards and committees, and they may disagree with what the committee is doing, and they may conduct themselves in ways that they certainly appreciate that the representatives of the community that the representatives of the community should always try to remain civil to the public, and you know, this side of the table it's sometimes a little more difficult, but it's the marching orders we have for all of us. We expect it of the public, but we certainly require it of all of our appointees. The only other thing that to remind you of is if you were appointed, all the boards and committees turn over on a regular basis. Selectmen turn over every year. We encourage all members to think about leadership roles from time to time after they've had some experience with the subject matter and with the other members. So we would ask that if you were appointed, just keep in the back of your mind that the rotation of leadership is helpful for the workings of the committee and also to tap the expertise of all the members. So, not sure what we all want to do. We've had three interviews with three candidates. We appreciate the interest of all of them, obviously. We can, unfortunately, that means we at some point need to come to some conclusion about two of the three.
Well, we're going to look at some other people too, to see if we're other.
Yes, we have some other, we have a couple of other interviews.
Well, why don't we do that all at the same tonight, time at
then,
the end?
Okay. So, we will thank you, and we will be in touch.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
All right.
Yeah, can I give you something? Thanks.
So, we're a little ahead still, but We have two more interviews. As Mr. Jackson, Craig Jackson?
No.
No?
He's not here yet.
Okay, so he's scheduled another 5 minutes. So I guess we will wait a minute or two.
They're both here.
Okay.
Mr. Chair,
Flip-flop that?
To let you know, for the Trails Committee, we did have someone inform us today they were withdrawing their application. That was Robert and...
Santa Maria?
Santa Maria, correct.
Okay.
So it's perhaps possible that the other two gentlemen are...
All right. Well, hopefully that means then that Clem Larson?
Yep.
And Christopher Kowalczyk. Come on up. We'll skip to the Trails Committee. Thank you for coming in. So, routine will basically be the same. The selectman who's the liaison to the Trails Committee will do a quick overview, and then we'll ask you to talk about why you're interested in being on the Trails Committee. And there may be questions from the members, and we'll proceed from there. So, I don't know who the Trails Committee...
I have been, but I'm not sure that...
I think you still are.
Currently meeting or... Okay, so I certainly can introduce the committee.
Okay, well, why don't you give that a shot? Thank you.
So, welcome. The Trails Committee's focus is to promote a cohesive vision for the development of the trails and the network around Bedford. Most importantly, it's to look to establish new trails, new connections between public property, municipal buildings, other ways to kind of connect the town, to maintain the trails, the signage, the mapping on the trails all around town, create or organize town events, snowshoeing, hiking, things that will kind of bring visibility to the wonderful trail network that we have. It is a very involved group. Everyone there wants the best for the great trails that we have around town, and so we appreciate you offering to volunteer to be a part of it.
Great. So why don't I'll start with Mr. Kowalczyk. Why don't you just tell us a little bit about why you're interested, and if there's anything in particular about the Trails Committee that you're that you think should happen.
Sure. So my name is Chris Kowalczyk. I've lived in Bedford for 2 years now. Right across the street from O'Connor Conservation Area, which I serve as the land steward for. And my interest in the Trails Committee was primarily because I love the outdoors, but it's not just being an advocate. I've been attending meetings regularly since the beginning of the summer. And like you said, they're very involved, very passionate people, very impressed with the body of work they do to keep these trails up. I think any of us who have taken the time to enjoy any of the 17 areas in town can say they're all very well marked, always well established. They don't look run down, very well taken care of. And I would like to continue to be a part of that group that maintains these areas. I had the pleasure of leading a trail walk the first Saturday of the month, the October one, and just very interesting people you meet, really enjoy just exploring new areas. And I think that's one of the gems of this town is that we have this open space. And going to other towns and nearby, I run a lot and can say that the Bedford trails are much better maintained than many of the other towns. So it speaks to the kind of work that this committee does, and that's why I'd like to be a part of it and moving forward.
Very good, thank you. Larson?
Sounds like Chris and I have similar interests. I'm also a runner, very interested in trails. I've been involved with Trails Committee for volunteering for 3 years. I live at Hawkins Farm, so I have a volunteer with Trails Committee, but I've also been running the Hawkins Farm Trails Committee itself for the past 3 years, including meeting with the Conservation Commission on a subcommittee that we have to coordinate what we're doing. So in the past 3 years, we've actually established new trails, put in bog bridges, built bog bridges, put on a lot of signs. There's probably over a dozen signs we put in. We have flooded trails, and we've realigned some of the trails. We have actually an event this coming Saturday where we're reestablishing some of the existing trails that are flooded. We're moving them a little bit farther uphill within the easements that's out there. Last Saturday, we had a trail hike for members in our Hawkins Farm community. We had 14 people attend. And we usually run these about on an average of once a month, but this time of the year, we run them about two or three times a month. The rest in the summer, we don't run them at all because nobody comes out with the ticks and the and the mosquitoes. But we've been out in the wintertime on snowshoes and skis, kind of just an interest. And we've got several trails that we're actually going to propose, stop those, whether a member or not, doesn't matter. Just basically to do it improve. There's one at Minnie Reed, and there's also one from Old Causeway towards the Carlisle Bridge. We want to actually put a new trail in there on Hopkins property. There's various things we want to do to keep that alive and keep it going. And the main thing is to see if we can do it.
Very good. I will go to questions in 1 second, but I just have to say that it's very impressive and reassuring to see two people so clearly interested in what this committee does, volunteering to be on the committee. It's very, we very much appreciate the level of interest on the level of activity you're already engaged for. So are there other questions or comments? Yes.
When you, at Hopkins Farm, does your committee actually physically go out and clear the new trail, for instance?
Yeah, we do. We've got a committee with, I originally ran the committee, and I turned it over to somebody else when I moved up to the Board of Trustees. So, but I organized about half of the trails. We had a maintenance event last month to go out and for about an hour, I think turned out an hour, hour and a half to go clear some trails. Probably once a month this time of the year, we go out and do that as a committee. And we do it as a committee. It organizes it and then invite the community, so we get varying levels of support from the community. Sometimes we get none, sometimes we get five people, so it just varies a little.
That's great. That's great.
I spend most of my trail time in West Bedford where we don't have ticks or mosquitoes. it's amazing how that works. But that being the case, I wanted to ask Mr. Kowalczyk, because I haven't spent any significant time on the O'Connor property. Do you think there's any potential there for agriculture?
I don't know. It's on the Billerica line, and I know that when I first started exploring there's a lot of trails that go off into other areas, and that one part that goes along the fence, I don't know what company that is on Old Billerica Road there. I'm not sure. I don't know enough history about that property. I understand that's our newest conservation area, 2009 or mm-hmm. somewhere. So I don't know. I really don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. I was here, but I don't remember how it was farmed. The fact that it was farmed doesn't mean that it can be again, but that's the kind of thing that would really be a home run if a community group is interested. I've often fantasized about it, but I really appreciate your interest and your involvement.
Thank you.
I would just ask both of you if you have any familiarity with the Bike Ped Master Plan that has recently come before us, and they did a lot of outreach. So hopefully, if you were going to Trails Committee meetings and just being aware of things in town, that you had an opportunity to participate. And I just wondered if each of you could just say something about how you feel about Trails Committee, sort of the synergies that there are there in terms of broader connectivity through all parts of town and helping people get around. I mean, I know that primarily the trails are used recreationally, but they also have some, in certain instances, have a lot of potential for helping people get to parts of town that otherwise are not so easily accessible by foot or on a bicycle.
I went to the convening that was held about 3-4 months ago in the middle of summertime. Mm-hmm. Listened to the presentations. It was a great, interesting plan. I'm waiting to see how much funding and interest it is as far as follow through in terms of implementation. As an example, it was not introduced well in terms of like Hopkins Farm. It was basically just dropped on us and said, you got to go and what do you guys think about it? And it was like complete surprise. It was issued like it was an edict. And it was, and so as a result, and the big thing was nobody had researched the documents at Hopkins Farm to find out the bicycles are banned. So from our trails. So it wasn't possible that could ever succeed at Hopkins. So it created a big backlash. And I think if it had been sold a different way, that it would have succeeded. So That's a little disappointing, but the point, you know, we've already got probably a mile of easement, of trail easements for pedestrians to go through Huffins Farm as it is. So it should have been fairly straightforward to get it, but because it was introduced so poorly, it was disappointing. But anyway, that's, so, in terms of getting more people to do it, we found that a lot of people in Bedford don't understand that they got trails. We say, have you ever been over to Carlisle Road? And they said, yeah, you can drive down here and go out there, and if you want to go up along the road, and we said, no, you can go through here, that down past Harvard Lab out to this road, and we've shown people how to take the path. Have you ever been to Narrow Gauge Trail? Well, I don't know, what's Narrow Gauge Trail? You haven't heard of Fawn Lake? And so we walked the people over to Fawn Lake and said, wow, that's only a mile, mile and a half away from our place. It's unbelievable. And once we've also run a lot of people that say, I've been out running on trails or, you know, just running up and down Narrow Gauge Trail, and I end up running with people, like various people, you know, just run into them. And the guy says, hey, if I could help out as a volunteer, I'd love to do it, but don't make me go to trails meetings. I don't want, if you post it on a website, I'll come. Or you send me an email, I'll come. But please, don't make me go to a meeting. And there's a lot of people out there that are willing to volunteer, but they don't, and I'm not saying that if I told them this Saturday, come show up. Okay, there's always probability of something else to do. But there's a tremendous amount of stuff, and that's what we used to do before we moved here. Was we used to volunteer on an occasional basis. I was traveling a fair amount for business. I couldn't commit to make every Saturday I could do something, but on an occasional basis, there are a lot of people out there that would absolutely volunteer.
Great, thank you.
Yeah, I think along something Clem said was the linkages between the trails. So I know when you first get exposed to them, a lot of the trails are, you know, under a mile long. And my own selfish interest was how many of these can I loop together and try and link them as much as possible. I think over by Huckins is great. You can do Mini Reed, Altman, Causeway. There's the one over on the other side of the road that goes into Carlisle. The new plan to connect from Reformatory to Narrow Gauge would be huge, because you come down Narrow Gauge and, you know, you like running on non-concrete, and then you got to get to the Reformatory, you got to cut over on railroad, and there's not really a path there early in the morning, buses, whatever. And I just think that's a perfect example of, you know, linking that. You can go all the way into Great Meadows. I think there's a lot of endless possibilities to loop a lot of these together, and I'd be very interested in helping foster that and educating people.
I saw the trails map that we were all recently given copies of, I think, and that was very enlightening, even though I was familiar with a lot of that information. It was just really nicely put together. So I think that there are opportunities to reach people different ways, and I'm glad that there's some paper versions that for folks who maybe aren't so comfortable going online and checking out the maps. And it's great that you can hand it to people and say, these are our conservation areas and these are the trails that are in them. So I encourage everything possible to educate our residents about these resources and get them out using them. Because I think you're right, this is a huge asset that the town has.
I'll just add a comment, just because I'm not sure if you're aware of it. So the Land Acquisition Committee is another committee in town. I'm the selectman liaison to that as well. And we focus on, we've been focusing on easements around town to help connect trails or connect, just basically increase the connectivity around town. And when I first started being liaison there, we had somebody from the Trails Committee join regularly to our meetings because we have similar interests and we should have similar conversations. And whether it be, you know, a public easement or approaching somebody for, you know, purchase of a private easement or whatever the case might be, if we all pool together our resources and approach those issues or those potential easements to connect, the better for all of us to be. So I think that there's some synergies in our committee, so I would welcome you, if you are appointed, to join one of our meetings as well, and just, you know, kind of keep yourself abreast of what we're doing.
All right. I'm hoping that you all heard my little rendition of conflict of interest and open meeting law and those things, because those would also apply should you be appointed. We certainly thank you for coming in. There are two vacancies and we have two candidates.
Move that selectman appoint Clem Larson and Christopher Kowalczyk to the as members of the Trails Committee to terms expiring June 30, 2016.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, abstained, 5-0-0. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
You will get an appointment slip in the mail, and you'll need to come in and get sworn in at the town clerk's office. And then you're good to go.
Thank you.
We very much appreciate it. Thank you very much.
This must be your other one.
Shoo, excuse me. This is not a good sign. This is not a good sign. When I start to sneeze, it's not a good sign.
All right.
I was tired today, too.
My next agenda item is a contract award for...
Mr. Chairman, could that be the candidate?
No.
No, it's not.
Actually, that's the Trails Committee.
Oh.
We heard, I mean, you confirmed with Mr. Jackson for bicycle?
Yeah.
Yeah, when I first...
All right.
Sorry.
That's okay. So we are on to contract award for Shawshene Pump House Restoration.
Oh, there he is. Let me, Mr. Lonnie's out here.
Okay. Yep.
Is this the historic building on
yes,
next to the reservoir?
Yes. Well, actually, it's on Shawshene.
On Shawshene Road.
Yeah, we're very efficient. You've got to come a half an hour early. Just to be on time.
I knew it. I knew you guys were good.
Yes, we've been moving right along.
Good evening. So this is for the Shawshene Pump House, the exterior restoration and renovation. As the memo stated, we bid it under Chapter 149, and the work involves the partial slate roof repairs and the windows, the eaves, the trims, the soffit. So it's mainly really exterior. We had about 12 plan holders and only 3 people bid on it. And Eagle Points Builders of Belmont was the lowest, most responsive bid winner.
When you get done, it won't look like a crack house anymore?
It will look really nice.
Oh, boy.
What?
Okay. Are there any other questions about the project or comments?
It will look so nice that you'll want us to do the second one.
Will the windows actually be, is it look in or?
Yes, so there is actually the ones on the street side, you will be able to look in during the day. In the evening, we have a blanket or something that we will cover so everyone can look in. Yes.
Anybody think that structure would warrant some signage?
As to what it is?
Like a plaque or something?
Yeah, I mean, some of the historical society might be interested.
I feel as though there is something there.
I remember seeing something there.
Because it's part of the original historic water system, the first water system, and I've walked up in there, and I feel as though there's something there, but I don't know if it's attached to the building or if it's...
It is attached to the building, yes.
Yeah.
It's not standing alone.
Mm-hmm.
A freestanding sign.
Yeah. Maybe I'll mention that to the Historic Preservation Commission at their next meeting.
I seem to recall, and it wasn't me, but I believe that one selectman had some concerns about the trucks coming in next to the building and bumping the shingles, or so there was something with the overhang. And I believe there was going to be either a bollard or a boulder or something placed strategically so that wouldn't happen anymore. I just wanted to confirm that.
Yes, we're going to put 2 of them at least at the corners.
Great.
So that we force the trucks to
Great.
Take a wide open.
Avoid the building.
Yeah, if we're okay. Putting all this effort into it.
All right. Is there a motion to...
I move that the town award a bid of award the contract to the Eagle Point Builders Incorporated of Belmont, Mass. In the amount of $110,800 for the renovation of the exterior of the Shawshing Pump House.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, abstaining, 5-0-0. Thank you very much. All right, and now, our next item is an update on the pavement management program.
Good evening, Mr. Chair and members of the board. So tonight, I will be doing the pavement management update, which I've done for the past 2 years. This is the pavement management program that we have through Phase Quaffen and Thorndike, as you all know. Which the report usually comes out in the spring. I like to hold it till this time of year as we get into the capital preparation season. Let's see. I believe you all have copies as well.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Pavement manager, that's the public work. So as you know, we work with Phase Quaffen and Thorndike. We started with them back in, I believe it was 2005 or 2006, I believe, is when this program was first put in place. And the basis behind this program, as I've mentioned before, is we try to establish what our pavement index is, and that's how you get an idea of the actual pavement surface within your community. Our PCI, as you know, is a rating from 100 is the best, 0 obviously is an extremely poor road. Each year, FSD comes and inspects 1/3 of our roads. This past April, as I mentioned when they were here, our PCI was set at 62.7. As I mentioned before, we'd like to get a PCI of 70 to 73. Of course, in order to do that, a lot of it has to do with funding and how much money we're putting back into the road program. These are the different treatment bands, and we'll go through these some more, but you have a do-nothing band. That's a road that is basically a brand new road. Routine maintenance, preventive maintenance, structural improvement, and base rehabilitation. Base rehabilitation, that's when you come in and completely reclaim the road, regrade it, and repave it base and top. That's the most expensive band. Here's a snapshot of what they present or what their software has. This is in no particular order of importance. This is just a random slide that's put together. It's actually cut and pasted from different parts of the program. But it does show you the different segments, which in our system, our roads are considered an asset, and each asset or road has a segment ID, route ID, from and to. And then the recommended activity and or the PCI. They also have cost in here that they can establish based on the activity they're calling for that road. Here's our distribution for the previous 4 years. And we'll get further into the slides, but you can see a couple of areas we want to be a little concerned with coming into this coming year. And these numbers will also change from the work we've done this year as well. We have done more paving this year, but our do-nothing PCI, which was extremely strong, particularly on our arterial and heavily traveled roads, has dipped down, and our base rehab, which as I mentioned is the most expensive method, has increased as well. So we talked about what the backlog is. What is the backlog? That's if we were going to fix all our roads today, how much would it cost? I didn't put this in as a capital item this year. I thought the $15 million request might be a little out of line. So, but anyways, this is just certainly a benchmark indicator of what you need to do. Just as I put in red, and I just want to caution that I probably should put a different color. It's not really a red flag. We have got to a point where we're looking, as I mentioned in the previous slide, of more base rehab. And 5 miles throughout the town from our last examination, we have fallen out of the do-nothing band. But that's typical of a road anyways. Once you fix a road, that does not mean that road obviously never needs nothing done anymore. So that's something we need to keep an eye on, I think, particularly this year and next year. And that's where we'll need to focus on the preventative maintenance aspect or that band. moving into the coming years. But you can kind of see how that number, I think the backlog last year was around a little bit under 13 million, okay? So that kind of cranked up the backlog this year, moving into the coming season. Our PCI overall, our average throughout our four different categories, pretty much stayed the same, even though our overall PCI dipped. As you can see, our arterials and our collectors, which are our main roads, are in extremely good condition. Our residential locals and residential dead ends, the PCI is down quite a bit. You know, as I mentioned, we want to be around 70. You can see they're in the 50s. However, we have done a lot of residential and dead end work this year. So I think when we get next year's report, you're going to see that come up and get us back to a point where you'll see that improvement being made as far as the residential locals and dead ends. So when you talk about PCI, and remember, this is just an indicator. So a lot of communities, they're in the 60 to 70 range. I have talked to other directors in other towns who claim their PCI is 75, and you ask them what kind of pavement management program you might have. Well, we have our own in-house program. It's an indication or an index of what you have. So when you look at this PCI, which is an average road of 63, this road is not in bad condition. It's actually in pretty good condition. There is some minor cracking that you would do with some crack sailing. You do have, it looks like we had some trench work done over here with some pavement overlay. The biggest thing are our older residential roads in town that were put in back in the 60s. As methods were different back then, you see a lot of cracking and heaving because of the subsoil gravels as well. Those are the ones that are most expensive. They could be completely redone, and we have been working our way towards that this year. So we go through this analysis each year, and we usually put out these same scenarios of A, B, and C, which is a $1.2 million annual funding, $1.5 and $2 million. Our backlog has moved up this year, and as a result, you can see our spending, or our recommended spending, has crept closer to $2 million per year in order to get that backlog down and also get our PCI up. So this chart kind of tells you that. And if you looked at this last year, as I mentioned, we were more in around the $1.5 to $1.7 million range to get our PCI raised closer to up towards the 70 number, whereas this year it's more like that $2 million number. So here's kind of shows you right here, it's the $2 million number recommended through FST. If that's what we spent, we could look at getting our PCI up to 69 in a short span of time versus a longer span of time, where we either flatten out or continue to drop down a little bit based on these funding levels. Chapter 90, as you know, this past fiscal year, we that extra $100 million was finally released, so we ended up with a little over $900,000 this year. And that was a big topic over the past 2 years, was if we did get that $900,000, we were getting closer to that overall funding number we wanted. But this year, we're back to our $600,000. So the funding now is going to come back down to where we were previously, which is with the operating budget money of $650,000, as well as the Chapter 90. We're still around 1.2, 1.3. As I mentioned, we did get this extra amount this year, and we have been able to do additional work, particularly in the smaller roads in town. So moving forward with our 10-year pavement management plan, one thing we have to watch for, and what we see in here is because our preventative maintenance, we're going to have to start to focus on that so we can keep our structural improvements down. Because we haven't been really in the preventative maintenance band as we should be, and that's something that as a public works department we're going to have to focus on, our structural improvements have increased a little bit. And these are the two areas where you really don't want to get into increase. And you can see this one here, our mileage and base rehab went up quite a bit. That's also the most expensive band. Now, that's not to say if we did do the preventative maintenance that this figure here probably wouldn't be as high, but it still would have risen, basically based because on the age of the road itself. These preventative maintenance bands and treatments are basically, they're extending the life of the road as much as you can, and they're only done to roads that are worthwhile to do that treatment to. We wouldn't do it on an older road where the substructure of the street was completely compromised. So as I mentioned, our goal is 70 PCI. We want to try to stretch that PCI out through the bands to make sure that we're not concentrating too heavy in one area and we're struggling in another. So I think we need to do a little bit of a better job at that. Obviously, we want to always reduce our general maintenance costs, and Adrian does a great job coordinating with the utilities to make sure that whatever roads that they're working on, we schedule to have those roads paved shortly thereafter, particularly with some of our cleaning and lining projects as well, with the water. We try to wrap all that in at once. So funding's a big topic on this. You know, in the past years, I've said around 1.2 to 1.5, up to 1.7 in that area. This year's latest report shows us that we should really start to elevate that funding. We'll be going forth this year to look for, and this goes in our capital planning as well, that you'll see as we move forward, of our funding of $700,000 right now. We want to increase that 2.5% each year. As I mentioned, you'll see that as we come further with the finance director, Victor Garofalo, and myself, and town manager Rick Reed, as we present our capital plan moving forward. Now, Chapter 90, could we end up with more Chapter 90 money? That we don't know, that could happen, but I think the thinking was that they would maintain those levels that would keep us at $900,000 a year, and I'm not sure that that would be the case. And obviously, we want to keep an eye on the funding and have it equal to market pricing. So this is a kind of a graph I've worked out. This shows our funding throughout the years, what we put forth towards the roads. Here's the price index of asphalt during that time. As you can see, it has increased 65%. This highlighted area up here in yellow is the area we should be in. Now, we did get to it. As I mentioned, we did get the $900,000 from Chapter 90 that helped us get in here. But now as we come back down, we want to try to stay up in this area here. Obviously, we don't want to keep dipping or even flatline here because we will fall behind further on our road network and the PCI on that network. As I mentioned, here's our six-year capital plan. You see a raise slightly over the years, the coming years moving forward. Again, we're climbing closer to 2 million, but we're not quite there. But this is probably a good area. This is FY22 right now. The blue, just to delineate here, the blue is last year's six-year capital plan, and then the red is this year's, which we have looked at the paving numbers and adjusted those according to our the information we have gotten back.
Now, that doesn't include Chapter 90, right?
Yes, it does.
It does.
It would be Chapter 90 and operating budget money. So the red would be our plan as presented this year, so the blue just gives you an idea of what we did with our numbers this year, raise those up some more. So here's our conclusion. Our since this was put in place, the roads certainly have improved within Bedford. Our PCI fell slightly last year. I certainly don't like to report that. I'm not going to say we should get failing marks because of that. I think you're going to see that go up next year based on us getting into the residential areas. As I mentioned, the main roads are in exceptional condition. We have to do better at our preservation maintenance. The biggest thing I think that we'll talk about this year and throughout the next 6 months, particularly as we get to the town meeting as well in the budget season, is that $1.5 to $2 million a year number. We would like to be there. I will tell you this, we did struggle this year quite a bit, just being support for the paving program, which is public works staff being out, looming the roads, doing the driveway aprons, seeding and all that, because we do that collateral work with the companies. We did have some staff down, so that could be a reason, but in order for us to maintain that, or if we can commit to this funding level, we would have to obviously look at A, our staffing numbers, and or B, offering more out to contracted services. So that's something we're gonna have to figure out what that cost might be. But that would mean that the paving contractor and or we would put out a material or service request, as we do every year, to have someone else loom those edges or do small paving aspects of our paving program for us. So. So with that, that's the conclusion of the PowerPoint for tonight, and I'll answer questions as best of my ability. I was going to have Adrienne here tonight. We did get on early, so.
Oh, she just walked up.
Oh.
You said her name and she came through the door.
So we can certainly go back to any slides if you want, or we can take some questions.
So if you, even if you allocated $2 million a year for the next 5 years,
Yep. The
backlog would still grow by $4 million now.
The backlog would come down. It raised quite a bit last year. It's going to continue to grow, but it raised significantly this past year than it did last year. It went from 13 to 15 million.
So I guess I didn't understand the slide called budget analysis.
Let me see if I can get back. Which one was
there
this
it.
One?
No, wait a minute.
The one that.
That's the one here.
Yeah.
So I'm looking at the green. That's $2 million a year, but it.
Correct. That's based on current right now. Now that would certainly, if we maintain that $2 million level. It would be at the 19.6 million. It would grow over those years, so you are correct when you say that. So it would be the next five or six years.
So even the best case scenario, which we're not even talking about, because the capital plan is the one in the middle, right?
The capital plan is not, this is strictly off the budget analysis from the consultant. Our capital plan recommendation would be that other slide that I had up there. Right here. So that we're not even at the $2 million mark based on operating budget as well as Chapter 90. So we're actually below that. We're below that budget analysis. So you'd be more, if we go back to this slide, we're more in the blue area, that blue line, as opposed to the green.
So right there, that's showing that based on this year's capital plan, we would expect to see a $22 million backlog.
Correct.
If we reduce that by $300,000, we would see a $24.3 million backlog. But if we went to $2 million of expenditure this coming year, then we'd see the backlog drop to $19.6 million.
Correct.
And then next slide shows the difference in PCI as a result of those levels of investment choice. That's 69, 66, and 62 are the resulting PCIs as a result of the three scenarios.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
I just want to clarify, and maybe this has to do with budgeting and when monies are received and spent. So in fiscal year 15, when we received the extra Chapter 90 funds, we came close to doing what would have been kind of our ideal or our practical ideal of being able to put almost that 1 million, you said 900?
900,000, yeah. So
right.
the operating budget at the time, so 3 years ago was around 600, increased to 650 this past year. 50, you can correct me if I'm wrong, and then coming in was 700.
We're putting in the post 700.
Correct.
Right.
So at the time when we presented the previous 2 years, that number of those two combined, we said we wanted to try to be around 1.5 million.
Okay.
1.2 to 1.5. Based on that and what we've seen and what FST is telling us is that that's really lower than we should be operating. We should be looking at it. As 1.5 is the absolute minimum, you want to be closer to 2.0.
Okay. So even with that extra injection of the Chapter 90 funds, still, according to their analysis, was not enough to stay on a positive trajectory.
No, because that funding should be maintained throughout,
okay.
Whereas that extra money from Chapter 90 was that 1 year.
So was there a reason that in the year that we had more money, if not enough money, was also the year that our backlog increased, or is there an offset in terms of
the? No, so we're seeing the benefits of that money actually.
Now, okay. All right, so it just those two things happened in the same fiscal year,
okay.
But it wasn't that we spent a lot of extra money and our backlog increased.
Yeah,
we are spending that money now,
correct.
To address the backlog.
Correct.
Okay.
like to talk to you about philosophy for a second and money for a second. First of all, the $650,000 of operating budget pays for labor and materials?
It pays for anything to do with paving. So that's contracted work, strictly.
Does it pay for DPW?
No, we have our own.
So there's no DPW costs in any of these numbers, but there's DPW labor.
Yeah, which comes out of our operating budget, just under a separate line.
Okay. Then philosophically, it strikes me that you could raise the PCI pretty quickly by doing what you mentioned you did some of this summer, which is working all the community roads and let the other ones sit for a year.
Yeah, you just got to be careful. I mean, unfortunately, you want to pay closer attention to your arterial roads because those are the most heavily traveled roads. They're the ones that are going to endure the most wear and tear immediately. So it certainly is a fine balance. We have gotten into those residential type roads this year. We have done a lot of paving this year. It's been extremely difficult, as I mentioned. We're still going, and we'll be going right up until the snow comes down, trying to get some of this stuff wrapped up. And, you know, certainly other areas from an operating budget of other work that we could be doing is kind of falling back a little bit.
Can you hint? I don't know if hint is the right word. You stated in the last slide that the two issues are the amount of money you have to buy subcontractors and a need for more personnel.
Yeah, as I mentioned, so this program, it's good because it tells you where you should be. But then you have, you know, you talk about philosophy, but you also talk about logistics. Can we logistically do $2 million worth of work each year? Right now, no, we can't. And that's a couple of reasons why. It would be extremely difficult to do that just from a paving aspect, but certainly from a staffing aspect as well. We'd have to look at how we might do that. I think we want to get closer to that. We've presented that with our capital plan and our funding each year. I think that'll get us to a level we want to build towards and then climb closer to that. If we just said we were going to do a bunch of work all at once, it would be extremely difficult to do that.
So I'm trying to figure, are you more labor constrained or are you more dollars constrained? If you had more dollars.
It's a combination of both, David.
The standard is labor constraint.
Internal labor.
Because most of the cleanup work, you know, the adjusting of the driveways, the looming and seeding, the gravel along the shoulders, is done in-house.
So if you had the $2 million and more personnel, you could do even more than the $2 million worth of, you could handle a little more?
Well, I think we would have to balance that between what we have in-house and then certainly have some of those services contracted out, which means you're paying to have someone else doing the edges of the road versus having them putting asphalt on the road. So.
And your preferences?
My preference would be to continue to do it the way we are right now, except, as we mentioned, the additional workload of the additional paving has certainly hurt us. We have had...
Yeah, your PCI doesn't change if you have a contract to spend your highway money looming and seeding.
Correct.
PCI, so it's...
No.
Yeah.
Now, from a staff point of view, too, we have had some movement with staff this year. So it could be it's a combination of things, but people had left, we've hired new people on board this year, and we did a lot of paving. So certainly those things are connected with one another.
Thank you.
Other thoughts or questions? So I want to raise something I think I raised the last time, and now I think it's looming even more, because as we head toward special town meeting, and we're asking the town to adopt complete streets, mm-hmm. and then at some point we'll end up with a complete streets policy. Nothing about this addresses the other big ribbon of pavement that runs through the town, which is all the sidewalks, which are also in disrepair in many places. I mean, some of them are great. I mean, it's the same full range. There are some that are really nice, some that are recent, and some that are concrete, so they're going to last significantly longer. And then there are other roads where, you know,
so
I mean, impassable is not the word, but difficult and awkward, and especially as we talk about trying to use these facilities more broadly, and we have on the one hand In some cases, more children running, and in other cases, more older folks, you know, just walking, because it's, should be easier to do what they want to do walking than it would be to get in their car. So I'm just concerned that, you know, there's a whole nother aspect of this, and we need to figure out how to address that PCI for a different kind of pavement.
So with the sidewalks as well, and we certainly coming into this year, we want to look at getting some additional sidewalks put in, more so than we did. That just didn't happen this year for a number of reasons. Certainly, we want to try to get that next spring. You know, for example, Concord Road sidewalk, we did have some more drainage issues there than we thought. We started to do some drainage work out in front of the nursery. There's additional drainage work that needs to be done before that sidewalk can go in. Just run out of time at this point. And as I mentioned, we're trying to wrap up most of the paving program that we've put in place. But yeah, you raise a good point as far as there is that whole other.
Well, and there will always be additional proposals for new sidewalks, but
yes.
I'm as concerned about the condition of the current sidewalks.
And yes.
Some of them are just old style, very narrow, 4 feet, heaved with roots, and, you know, partially passable just by the same kinds of things, I guess, that DPW could, you're saying, you know, they're loaming and seeding in places where new pavement has gone in, and there are also places where shrubs need to be cut back. I know it's a certain amount of responsibility for property owners to do that, or at least they can be, they can be reminded that it's their responsibility. We do have a 3-season, you know, passable sidewalk requirement. You're not required to move snow and ice, but you are supposed to be keeping sidewalks in front of your property clear. But I, like I said, I mean, there's an entire universe of paths out there, sidewalks, paved sidewalks that need as much attention as some of these roads.
So. I was going to ask, when you looked at you gave us the PCI treatment band ranges, sort of generally what they mean, and then kind of what you're going to have to do about them.
Yeah.
Sort of piggybacking on what Mark was just saying, as we look forward, hopefully, to being able to implement the Bike Ped Master Plan, I know that our consultants said that there were opportunities. If you were going to be rebuilding streets, then those would be the moments when you would, you could implement this at an incremental cost rather than doing it as a standalone project. But I guess I'm sort of wondering, along this continuum of actions that we take with our roadways, at what point is it substantial enough to trigger doing some portion of the bike ped? Does it have to wait until it's a complete rebuild, or is there a place along these way in this continuum where you would go and you'd consult that plan and you'd see what was being envisioned and you would see how much of it you could implement?
Well, on both of two of our projects this year, Walsh and Ashby and our project, Carlisle Road, we implemented a new sidewalk and then a bike lane. So we're thinking of that now as a mode of, you know, benefits when we have the road torn up for whatever reason. But I think you're asking, for instance, can we do an aspect of the bike ped master plan if we're not doing the roadway?
If it's not a complete rebuild.
If it's not a complete rebuild of the road, if it's someplace intermediate to a full, you know, grading down or
well, like on Carlisle Road,
mm-hmm.
It was just a mill and an overlay.
Okay.
So not a complete, no full depth. And in that case, since we had no roadway, we could take the opportunity to restripe it,
mm-hmm.
to have wider shoulders.
So this is just sort of operationally something that you're keeping in mind with all of your roadway activities. Okay. That's good to know. Thank you.
I guess I just want to thank you both for putting sidewalks over at the Housing Authority. It's much appreciated.
I've gotten a lot of good feedback about that project.
Well, yeah. It was like, oh, they don't need full width of roadway. It's one way, so let's get the advantage there.
Mm-hmm. That's a situation where that works good because of what currently exists.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
Right. We had mm-hmm. so much right of way. Right. Unusual.
Okay. Any other thoughts, questions? appreciate the update.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Forward to more progress. All right. We are on to a special town meeting warrant. Any remaining recommendations, and we need to assign ourselves presentation responsibility. So we have a warrant and we have the proposed motions so far. And so, forced to shut down.
So, what could go wrong?
Exactly, what could go wrong? So we have some recommendations to be made at special time meeting, but Rick, I'm trying to think of what has changed on any of them.
Well, so
the zoning bylaw, obviously, the conversion.
That I can report on, although I don't have a whole lot of information. I think I gave you a little info in the town manager's report. That the planning board is recommending disapproval of Article 2, which is the zoning bylaw amendment to allow some additional residential units to be built at the Page Place condominium complex. I don't know which one of you.
I was
so
there.
Caroline may have gone to the meeting. I don't know.
I was there.
Okay, so she could give the board of fill in on some of the discussion, but it essentially boiled down to concern about the size of the units that would be proposed to be built, and then some concern about whether or not there should be any affordable component to the new units being developed.
Right, and those were two of the biggest. I had taken some notes. So obviously there was discussion about having an affordable unit. The square footage right now is a max of 2,400 square feet for 15 units, and the planning board feels as though that's too big. They were looking for kind of a happy medium for a number of, and you know, there were different opinions across the board, but there were people who were worried about the number of bedrooms. There were people who were concerned about that being too large of a unit. They felt as though there was a lack of outreach to, you know, kind of the community and as to what they'd like to see or, you know, input. They commented on the fact that this came very last minute, and they didn't really feel as though they had time to digest and research as much as they would have liked to. What else? It was pushed through too fast. The property owners did try to listen to the planning board's suggestions, but not enough, in their opinion. And it was voted down, voted to disapprove.
Was it unanimous?
It was unanimous.
I understand at the end of the meeting, Attorney Brown suggested that an amendment might be offered.
Yes.
At town meeting.
Yes.
I was out at Joe Blaine House for a yard sale with the Historic Society. Oh, pardon me, the Joe Blaine people were holding on Saturday. And ran into the town moderator, and she indicated that she didn't think such an amendment would pass muster because you're not allowed to be more restrictive. And the question comes, is reducing the size of a unit from in the bylaw from 2,400 to, pick a number, 2,100,
mm-hmm.
isn't that being more restrictive? and therefore such an amendment would be out of order, and so the, what you see is what you get. I don't know if town council's being asked to opine about that or not.
I have not been approached to ask town council about that yet.
I'll leave that up to town moderator. So, any change in this that would deal with the problem that the planning board's talking about on town meeting floor probably isn't gonna work.
Which, could she not just move it differently, in the sense that when we went, no, so when we went to print with the warrant, I mean, for example, with the next article, Article 3 zoning map change, they haven't had their public hearing yet. And presumably, the whole process of having a public hearing allows there to be changes. So does this mean that, because this is the way that this article was printed in the warrant, is the way that she has to move the article? The petitioner has to move the article?
I'm not an expert on these things, but I was told that's my understanding.
It's my understanding the only way that she could move it differently would be to move it in a less restrictive way. Mm-hmm. You cannot go to town meeting and suddenly have an even stronger zoning bylaw or a more restrictive zoning bylaw than what was printed in the warrant. I don't see how the petitioner's article would be under any other rule either. I mean, the same thing. They're not going to be able to come and say, they'll be able to say this will be better or less restrictive, sure, in some way, but I'm not sure what, Was there discussion about, at one point, the trade-off on the affordability keyed in part on greater access across the property to other places on either side, and I don't recall whether or not they
ever said whether... That did not come up at this last meeting. And it might have come up at the prior meeting. What was spoken was that there was feedback from the planning board at the meeting prior. Some was taken into consideration, but not enough. And my guess is that they were kind of implying about this.
I don't think there was any linkage established between the affordability issue and the connectivity issue.
No, the only linkage that I was aware of was that there were folks who might have been willing to be more lenient on the requirement for affordability if they saw strong connections across the property to...
I think different planning board members objected differently.
Yes, exactly.
Some people did not feel so strongly about the affordable component, and some people may presumably had not felt so strongly about the connectivity, but nonetheless, I mean, I think that... The pity, in a certain sense, about the situation is that there are things in this bylaw amendment that definitely improve the bylaw as we have it now, in those terms that are set out about the sort of the expectation of public access to this property that are spelled out in the purpose, that are completely absent from the existing bylaw. But the issues that came up during the public hearing and presumably also during the deliberations that the planning board had were really much more the sort of nuts and bolts impacts to the community, especially with the size. And at the time, actually, I guess this was before the warrant was printed, they were saying 4 bedrooms. So they brought that down to 3, but I think that nonetheless, there was a lot of concern that you were adding large units with a lot of bedrooms.
Just to be clear, the counter argument that you might possibly make that says that making an amendment to reduce the size of the unit is not more restrictive is to say I'm creating a more open social good, but I don't think bylaws work that way.
A smaller number has to be more restrictive.
That's my opinion too. So are we wanting to take a position tonight, or do we want to?
I'll move that Selectmen recommend disapproval of Article 2.
Is there a second?
Second.
I think that the worst case is petitioners can go back and do some fine tuning and bring it back in the spring.
Yeah, I think that had there been a slightly longer process and one that had begun with more neighborhood inputs, They might have gotten to a satisfactory conclusion, and I think they just ran out of time.
March is still coming.
Yeah.
Although it would behoove them then to withdraw.
Withdraw, right.
Rather than...
Did that come up?
Yes.
So was it suggested by the planning board that they withdraw it?
Yes.
And so was there any response to that suggestion? Okay.
Otherwise, they'd have to wait, what, a year?
Well, unless they so improved at the planning board, then held a hearing and voted in favor of it.
There's a time...
Right, they wouldn't, I think the time limit is that they can't go forward unless there's a positive vote of the planning board. So unless they can win over the planning board before trying to go to town meeting again, I think that's how that statute works. But anyway, it doesn't really matter. So it's been moved and seconded to recommend disapproval of Article 2. Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, abstained, 5-0-0.
Article 3, I think we should wait until the next meeting.
Until the hearing, yes.
Yep. And I also, I brought it to the attention of the Zoning Board of Appeals just because this arrived, as we know, so last minute that I wanted to make sure that the ZBA had an opportunity to attend as individual members the planning board's public hearing.
That's tomorrow night?
No, it's the 27th.
Week from tomorrow.
It's a week from tomorrow. So I don't know necessarily that the Zoning Board of Appeals will have the opportunity to meet, although they may, if they choose to take this up to make a recommendation. But as they were the body that became sort of embroiled in this issue last year, I thought it was really important for them to be brought up to speed with this and to have the opportunity to weigh in.
Okay. Rick, Lavender Lane, you had us...
The planning board has recommended approval of street acceptance of Lavender Lane, and then I have received input from the Public Works engineer that they believe that the road is ready for street acceptance.
And the street sign is spelled correctly.
Yes.
I move that the selectmen recommend approval of Lavender Lane acceptance.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor of recommending approval of Article 4, say aye.
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 Opposed, abstained, 5-0-0.
The next one would be the operating budget amendments, Article 11.
Mm-hmm.
If you turn to your motion and your package for Article 11, the proposed changes to the operating budget. In the area of principal and interest, the changes there are really mostly the result of more updated information on projects, current information with delays and timing and interest rates and whatnot. Victor, I don't know if you want to elaborate any more on principal and interest changes.
So initially when we had proposed the principal and interest budget, we had assumed that these projects were going to start earlier in June, and we also assumed that the cost of the sewer main was going to be the full dollar value. In fact, if that was not the case, actually $1 million less, and the town hall project didn't start until after July 1st. So the numbers that are being proposed are the actual cost of those projects based on the bond sale that you just approved tonight.
Okay.
Those numbers not going to change?
Those numbers are not. No. None of these numbers in any of the votes are going to change.
In the case of the account 1310 financial committees, this is setting aside additional funding that relates to the Hanscom funding that we would hope to get in the event that the finance committee wants to just be careful in case there's some kind of cut in state aid during the course of this year, that they have a way to cover it in the reserve fund.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what that change is. And in school department, decreasing the appropriation of $170,435. Remind me what that is.
So that is reducing the 516, moving from the school department to the reserve fund. So initially, the 516 was in the school budget for the annual town meeting. The governor and the legislation has proposed to fund that. So we moved it out of the school department and put it in the reserve fund. But the decrease is, the next decrease is, we're moving the nurses to the school department. So you'll see a decrease in the nurses' budget.
So it's essentially a netting out of both a decrease in moving the reserve out for the school aid, and then adding in funds that are being transferred over from the Board of Health budget.
Okay.
Vocational ed is more students going to?
It's just taking into consideration the Minuteman Tech and the amount of students we have going in and Shawshin. With the Minuteman Tech, it's always and last year, we ended up having to go for a reserve fund transfer for those additional students, so we don't want to have that same situation this year.
In the Public Works Department, these are changes that are both related to the final cost of our borrowing that's being charged to the sewer fund, and updated information overall as determined when we set the rates in July or June for the current fiscal year. And then finally, the Board of Health changes, moving that funding from the Board of Health that ends up moving over to the school department for the nurses.
Okay.
Finance Committee moved on this yet?
They have not seen all of this.
The Finance Committee has not moved the motion. However, they have approved the model, which obviously has come from the model. So essentially, they would approve the motion because the numbers are already in the model. What would they think?
If we're nervous, we can wait.
Does it have anything else to change?
So, I mean, we could wait, but these are the numbers. The numbers are the numbers. Yeah. We don't anticipate the numbers changing.
These numbers are the numbers. They're not going to change between now and
so we could be out ahead of the Finance Committee.
I don't anticipate an issue.
In that case, I recommend the selectmen recommend approval of the operating budgets, Article 11.
Second.
Moved and seconded to recommend approval of Article 11. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, abstained, 500.
Now we'll go mess with the numbers.
So the next Article 12 is an amendment to the ambulance enterprise budget, and these amendments basically take into account final estimates based on our implementation schedule for the paramedic service. It started a little bit later, I think, than the originally estimated budget.
The one thing I will say is the Finance Committee has not seen these changes because the fire chief and myself met just last week, and we had not had a chance to present these numbers to the Finance Committee, although the numbers are worked out. The manager indicated the delay in paramedic service, the delay in the fourth paramedic being hired,
do you have any reason to believe the Finance Committee will change anything?
I have no reason to believe that the Finance Committee will disagree with my suggestions and reducing the budget.
Sort of housekeeping.
Yeah.
Move selectmen recommend approval of Article 12.
Second.
Moved and seconded to recommend approval. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, abstained, 500. So
I think the assignments and which ones.
Rick, let me just jump in because I see Ms. Lloyd from the planning board is here. We're ahead of schedule.
I can tell.
Already discussed the Article 2, and the planning board's deliberation and ultimate vote, had our own deliberation and vote, and selectmen will recommend disapproval of Article 2, although it'll now see whether or not that results in a withdrawal or whatever it might be, but just so you know.
I believe that the petitioner is intending to propose an amendment on the board. And ask them if they do that, please give us the language.
We had a little discussion about that also, as to whether or not it would be less restrictive and allowable or not, so.
May I ask what the vote was in terms of your?
That was unanimous vote to recommend disapproval, yes.
And may I also ask about Article 3?
Yeah, we have not taken a position yet because you haven't had your public hearing. Okay, so now we do need to run through assignments. There's not to be in any particular order. I'm assuming some of these are near and dear to some of you.
Can't imagine what you're talking about.
I don't know how that could possibly be.
I didn't think I was going to do anything this Tuesday.
Rick, could we just clarify that the operating budget amendments will be moved by the finance committee, will they not?
That's usually the practice, yes.
Yeah, okay.
Steve Stale will be moving the operating budget.
Yeah.
So that's 11.
And 12 to
13?
Both the operating budget and the enterprise account?
That's right.
Yeah, okay.
I'll take 8 and 9, the two community preservation articles, and I'll take 6, complete streets.
I thought I would take 10 and 7.
Wow.
Say that again. So 10 and 7. Margaret, what did you take?
What, 8 and 9?
6, 8, and 9.
Six, eight,
complete streets and the two community preservation articles.
Who would
can take 4 and 5.
Who would present three?
Actually the petitioner.
That's two. Three is a petitioner. Yes, yeah, so they're both petitioners.
Oh, so
we just need someone to stand up and give our petition for both of those.
Correct. I'm sorry, Caroline, which ones did you say?
Well, I had said 4 and 5 only because I,
yeah.
But now 2 and 3 are gone. So I can take 4 or 5 and I can take the other.
What, 13? Is that finance
any those,
awesome?
Any of those, which one? These are all standard.
13 will present it. I can stand up and do the selectmen's, you know, backup on the budget stuff. That's,
yeah.
That would be typical.
So you do 13?
Yeah, all three, all the 11, 12, and 13 are all really a selectman response, simply saying,
right.
Yes, we're all on the same financial page.
And you do one, correct?
Sure.
I'll just take the night off.
So there's 2, 3, 4, and 5 left.
You mean in terms of reporting on our...
Well, 4 and 5 are...
Oh, you got 4 and 5, 2 and 3 are petitioners.
Right, but right. So who's going to get up and give the...
Recommendation. I'll do 2 and 3 and...
Well, we haven't... The only thing I would hedge on is that we haven't taken a position on 3 yet.
Yeah, well, so. I mean, we will, right? We have to say something.
Yes, I just want to point out, though, that depending on how that discussion goes, we have historically had someone who represents the majority view of the selectmen actually be the person involved in the article. So depending on how we vote
sense.
On it, yeah. So that's the only reason I'm hedging on 3 is because we don't have a position on 3.
Mike, why don't you take 4 or 5 and I'll take the other.
Well, thanks. That's very generous. Which one would you like? I live near Lavender Lane, so
okay.
Maybe I'll take
it. There you go.
I can almost see it from my home.
Lake Rush.
So I'll take 5.
Okay.
So someone could take 2.
I can take 2. And then we'll wait on 3.
Okay.
But
right.
Assuming all goes well, Mike will. That was easy. This is easy.
Assume you're number one, Mark.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes. It's complicated, but I think I can probably do it.
It's real heavy lifting.
Well, all right. So, Rick, did you get all of those? The only one pending still is 3, just to make sure we...
Right.
Aren't putting anybody in an awkward spot. Okay.
Yes.
All right. So,
I have an assignment.
We are We are down to the minutes. Regular session, September 21.
I have something on page 3.
Mm-hmm.
Not exactly sure how I want to correct it, but it's third paragraph from the bottom, 1656, school enrollment study presentation. It says, started as Ms. Fidelli noted that Bedford is unique with its school structure from other towns. I just wanted to specify a little bit more what I meant by that. Mr. Sills was just describing how we have two elementary schools in town, one's K through 2 and one's 3 through 5, and how that's different from most towns around us, in that they have K through 5 in different locations. So is unique in the fact that their elementary schools are divided by grade level or something similar to that?
Mm-hmm.
We are unique, but.
I have a very minor editorial change on page 4 under 1658. The motion, Mr. Rosenberg made a motion to delete.
Mm-hmm.
Page 3, the first line under school enrollment study presentation, the superintendent spells his name J-O-N. More importantly, the last paragraph on that page, MSBA is the Massachusetts School Building Authority.
Yep.
Page 7, the very last paragraph, home funds, I think it's an acronym. I think the word home, yes, is all caps.
Yes.
And then it says, would be available to community members seeking rental assistance. I think we need to add the word qualifying community member.
Mm-hmm.
I have something on page 7 also, in those two paragraphs, or the paragraph right above, where I start, Ms. Fleischman stated that the Energy Task Force, so where it says this program allows citizens choice, actually what I was saying was this program would allow the town to negotiate on behalf of the town's, on behalf of electrical utility customers who are currently on basic service. So it's not, the community choice aggregation program is separate from, but related to the citizens' ability to choose, but the whole, mm-hmm, point was that we would be doing it on behalf of the citizens.
So would allow the town to negotiate
on behalf of residents, electrical, residential, well, I guess residential and commercial electrical utility customers who are currently on basic service.
Okay. Other changes, amendments, the motion?
I move the selectmen approve the regular session minutes from September 21st as amended.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, abstained, 500. Minutes of October 5th.
I have one small. Mm-hmm. First page, 1663, the BCC appointment.
Oh, sorry, man. I'll wait till the end.
In the first paragraph, it speaks of, as the selectman liaison to the Cultural Council, Ms. Fidelli explained the purpose of the committee as fostering diversity in the arts. I'd like to scratch from, so explain the purpose of the committee as, and then replace it with this. Purpose is to, as to support local public projects through the re-granting of the annual allocation of funds from the MCC. Although fostering diversity is great, I don't know the Cultural Council does that.
In that same paragraph at the end, the three words that start active this pursuit,
yes,
need to insert the word in between active and this.
Okay.
I have some others.
Mm-hmm.
I put a question mark next to 1665. I don't know how to change it, but it didn't seem to hold together. The state had $1.1 million for available funds. The eligibility is 20% of what? Victor?
What, 20% of the available existing debt?
It's all right.
Let me hand this to him. Let me hand it to him. He can read it, yeah.
Victor could probably just explain it to us again, and that can take the place of what's written there.
The state had $1.1 million of an appropriation for the sewer reimbursement. Does that sound?
Okay, and then the next sentence?
I think it's the town's eligibility. The town's eligibility is.
Maximum eligibility would be for existing debt. The amount of eligibility is 20% of which we are applying for reimbursement up to $148,000. I mean, we might not be granted the 20%, and one, mm-hmm. does it sound like we're going to get granted the 20%?
Mm-hmm.
So the eligibility is up to 20% of which we're applying for
Of just 1 year's
one debt. Year's debt service.
Yep. Nope, that's close enough. You can get together with her later to make it right.
I'm sorry, I wasn't paying attention.
You did a good job.
I caught you off guard. I apologize.
You have more, Bill?
Yeah, there's more. Article 10, Historical Museum Feasibility, page 5. Mr. Moonen commented that he believed. Then we go down to, he also highlighted that the Mass Cultural Council has matching grants for various historical projects. Don Corey added that there are several contributing sources that are, and then delete the rest of the sentence, that are available as funding sources. And then on page 6, Article 4, Mr. Moonen made a motion for the selectmen to recommend approval of Article 4. And the same thing down in Article 11.
We didn't do that one.
Am I wrong?
Wasn't that the one that I moved prematurely? Because we just moved
it
today.
Lavender Lane, yes, we held back, actually.
So, that, you know, I guess that's.
We started to go forward and then.
Right.
I moved it because I thought I was going to save some time. And then the town manager said, hold your horse.
So we just drop it?
We need to
delete it?
Correct it.
Well, the.
You could just say that you withdrew the.
Simon moved to. No, what did we do?
You withdrew the.
I was just correcting the English. I wasn't correcting.
I think we said we.
Give recommendation at
town. Made recommendation at town for us, Tom.
I mean, yeah.
So
I think what's missing is that Mr. Moonen made a motion for the selectmen to give a recommendation at town meeting.
That's what.
That's what.
So Mr. Moonen made a motion for the selectmen to give a recommendation at town.
Special town meeting.
This is Article 4.
It doesn't say at special town meeting.
It does.
At the end of the sentence. Do you want it moved up closer?
Yeah.
Yeah, move it up.
Yeah.
Or else you need the second dash.
I still can't see it.
Lavender Lane at special town meeting.
Okay, and then Article 11.
Yes.
Did we move that tonight too? Mr. Moonen made a motion.
Same thing.
For the selectmen to make the recommendation.
It says it there.
Same thing. Structure.
Yep. Yeah.
Same thing.
Yes, it's just a structure. It's a sentence structure thing. Yeah.
Okay, my problem, not yours.
Also 12.
Next page. The vote is missing on Mr. Moonen made a motion to approve the warrant for special town meeting without the zoning map change. I think the motion failed 1-4.
There was no second. There was no second. So the motion just flat out failed because there
was. Don't you need more explanation about why it failed? Wouldn't you want to say no second?
Well, you could say the motion failed for a lack of a second.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And finally, I'm sorry to be so confused about some of these things. Mr. Rosenberg made a motion, the next line down, to approve the warrant with Article 3. You delete the second Article 3. Zoning map change.
It should say including Article 3.
And to make its recommendation of Article 3 at special town meeting.
That's fine.
And just two more things, people, I'm sorry. Shawshing Tech, this is down in 1671, second paragraph. Shawshing Tech is planning a $6 million bond authorization for improving the athletic facilities at the high school. The approval by, not agreement of, the approval by the five communities involved in Shawshing Tech are required, period.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Bedford's share will account for 10% of the cost. And I do promise you this is the last one. Last page, 8. Mr. Moonen continued by saying he attended a finance committee meeting and heard concerns expressed, delete the word discussion of funds, concerns expressed that revolving funds and other designated funds collected by the town were, delete the words, not being used properly. That would be a bad thing to leave in there. Not collected by the town were inactive and or growing without apparent purpose. Yes, you may. I'm done.
Yeah, man.
All right, are there any other corrections?
Only because we look so closely at Article 5 and 6. there's an extra L in my name, in both.
Oh, I got one.
Never seen it.
I've got one.
We were in there deep, so I noticed it.
Under, right at the top, under present, it says I arrived at 7:14, but the meeting didn't start till 7:30, so
it was 8.
I might have been the first one here, but actually, I think I arrived at about 7:36.
Exactly.
About 7:36.
That sounds about right. 7:07.
He sauntered.
What's the matter? Don't you want credit for something?
I move the selectmen approve the regular session minutes from Monday, October 5th, as amended.
Second.
Move and second to approve the amended minutes. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, abstain. 5-0-0. Definitely a BCAT highlight. All right. Town manager's report.
Selectmen generally hold a holiday party reception in September.
December.
And this year at Double Tree Hotel, which is the location, has suggested December 14th, if that's okay. That's the second Monday in December. Should not be conflicts with other town boards or committees that night.
Yeah, and it's an off night for us. It's,
yes.
Yeah.
That's okay.
All right. Anybody have any concerns?
I had a book for our meeting.
Mm-hmm. Even better.
Okay. Thanks. That's all I have tonight.
Okay. Before we go to our own open discussion, do we want to take any action on Cultural Council? We have 3 candidates that we have interviewed. But we also have one candidate who we interviewed for 2 positions and have another person to interview for one of those positions. So, if you followed that at all.
So it's Kelly Dada who's the one in question.
Yes, and, that's right.
And whom are we waiting for community preservation?
So community preservation,
Maggie Dada.
Next, and she's scheduled for our next meeting? Okay. So the second candidate for community preservation will be in front of us at our next meeting.
And there are 2 vacancies or 1 for CPC?
There's 1 vacancy for CPC. There are 2 for Cultural Council.
Correct.
Yeah.
And there are two and a half candidates, or there were three for one and two for the other.
I'd like to make a suggestion, and you can tell me what you think of it. I feel strongly Ms. Dada has stepped forward and is a new resident, and it would be a pity for her not to be appointed to one or the other of these committees. And I don't necessarily want to say in advance which one that one is, but if we leave open one of the cultural council appointments, appoint one cultural council and leave open the other one, at the conclusion of our decision-making about community preservation, we could then choose whether or not Ms. Dada might fill the other cultural council. I mean, if we'd had all of the appointment interviews mm-hmm. for all of the committees that she wanted to serve on by now, we could make a decision. But I'd hate to not choose her for cultural council and then not choose her for community preservation, so.
I agree with your sentiments, but I'd like to hold off, and there's a lot of moving parts and
okay.
things.
And we can do that. That's fine too.
That's fine.
It's just another couple of weeks.
Anyone felt strongly about putting somebody in? Yeah.
Okay.
So we'll hold off on everything.
Thought we were going to have a problem with the Trails Committee too. But
okay. So then we are on to open discussion.
Sure. So the Rec Commission met recently, and the topic of conversation is next steps at Springbrook Park. And they came to the conclusion that they would like to request that the Springbrook Park subcommittee be reconvened. And just to remind everybody what that was 3 years ago when Springbrook Park was at a point that it was, there was no forward direction. It was appear to the staff and to the rec director that it was unsafe to continue in its current form. There was talk of closing the property, and there was a lot of opinions. The Springfield Park subcommittee was formed, and it was DPW, I think Board of Health, Rec, Bill and I were there. I believe I was there for Rec, and you were there for Selectmen. But in any case, it was a almost staff level. But so they're at the point again. Now they've done a study through Beals and Thomas, and feasibility, and that analysis is coming together, and I feel as though for the future of Springfield Park, they would like a committee to be reconvened to kind of look at the analysis, decide next steps, talk about budget, look at directions, perhaps get more insight from the community and from the public, but have it not be on the Rec Commission's to do.
So would the idea for this subcommittee or committee to be, again, a staff level committee, or would it be something more like the Fawn Lake Advisory Committee where they're receiving the information and analyzing and then reporting
back? Both ideas came up. The preference of the commission was to have it be more of a staff level because they're going to be the ones that are supporting the park. We talked about having the director of facilities, we talked about DPW, we talked about Rec, we talked about Selectmen, so these were all ideas they wanted to kind of put in front of us, but not so much to have it be a friends of or a at-large committee that we appoint because the people that are going to have to support the park in the end will be staff.
So the only concern that I would have under those sort of circumstances is that if that was a staff committee, I don't see where the public input would come in. It wouldn't be an open meeting.
Mm-hmm.
If we wanted to, if you know,
so yeah, good point. It's just open for discussion. They wanted right. the selectmen's mm-hmm. opinion. The last conversation was that they are leaning towards opening the park or recommending to open the park again in the current state. It just was. On a limited basis to residents only on a weekday basis for the next season. They haven't made that decision yet. They're looking at the results from the summer still, but that's kind of the direction of what they think as this longer term plan continues. But the study and the analysis is in and it's coming in. And so the sooner a committee is formed to kind of review that and know what we're doing with it, the better. Rick, am I missing anything that you have heard of?
No. I haven't actually heard very much about it.
Okay, just, it was just a couple nights ago, and...
Yep.
So who's the recipient of the study?
The rec director.
The rec commission, in effect, authored it through the expenditure from the revolving fund to study Springsbrook Park, to come up with a solution.
So I guess it's still not clear to me who else will see the study.
Who else will...
Who will ever see, who else will be able to see and respond to the study?
Well, I think that's the idea, is they don't necessarily want the rec commission to be analyzing an engineering study and coming up with next steps for a town asset by themselves as the rec commission. I think they're looking for...
Maybe it would make sense for the staff to begin the process by reviewing what the consultant has recommended and then give a report to the rec commission and the selectmen as to what perhaps would make sense next after that.
Sure.
You know, including potentially some kind of citizen.
Right, some kind of a task force or an ad hoc committee or something, but...
Because it sounds almost identical to the Fawn Lake situation. It's also it's a DPW. Some somewhat conflicting messages that we got was that it's important to document that currently there is still support for this idea. And so Energy Task Force felt that it was important to start by coming to the selectmen and confirm that we are on board with it, and then do additional public outreach and education for folks to understand what exactly this is and why it might be a beneficial thing to participate in. I think that's it, other than I'm going to the Hanscom Community Leaders event. I don't know if anybody else is going.
I'm going.
Okay.
I'll be there too.
Great, excellent.
That's Wednesday.
Yes, 8:00. Not 7:30.
Oh, dark.
They moved it. It was going to be 7:30 a.m.
Yeah.
And then there was a follow-up email saying that because of the schedule of the...
Just yesterday.
Yeah.
Probably. It's my time.
They moved it
email.
To a more
that every day.
Civilized
more hour. Gracious hour.
Yes, exactly. 8 a.m. Yes.
Okay. Mike?
I think I'm all set.
Okay. Bill?
I'm good.
Okay. So I did go to the MMA legislative breakfast. That unfortunately was also Friday morning. But I think, you know, nothing too earth-shaking. The MMA's presentation was fairly typical discussion of local aid and Chapter 90 and a variety of other efforts on our behalf. I think what I would say, though, is I thought it was interesting that the discussion afterwards amongst communities really hit on... Well, let me back up. There was one slight warning sign from the administration announced on Friday that the budget is behind and they're $145 million behind in their projected revenues for the current year, and that led to a few 9C comments. And
that was just one category of revenue.
Yes, exactly. I was going to say it wasn't really. There were several people who seemed to think that it was more onerous than others in a 38, whatever the $30 billion budget is, $145 million. Again, depending on the categories and depending on what they choose to do about it. But anyway, I thought the other thing that was more interesting, though, was that there was a lot of discussion on behalf of communities about opioids and various responses at the local level and the severity and the importance of it. A lot of discussion that then morphed into some sort of editorial comments, I think, directed at the legislature that there ought to be more attention to more preventative approaches to all kinds of issues that may or may not be leading to the ultimate problem of opioid addiction and abuse, really centering on better prevention around mental health issues and other ways in which people are prescribed and then led to this whole opioid problem. It was really kind of fascinating and interesting that there were so many people on the preventative end, as well as people who clearly are having some significant issues in their communities. And I'm thankful for the various forms of assistance, thankful for the governor attempting to at least set the stage for more action at the legislative level. We'll see how that transpires. The other two topics that were kind of interesting, a lot of interest in liquor licenses, the process for liquor licenses, why the legislature doesn't release more liquor licenses, basically on demand by communities as opposed to, in effect, requiring home rule petitions in order to get them. A fairly candid comment from a fairly senior member of the legislature who said that's because basically we want you to ask us and then we want you to be happy when we give them to you. Which may or may not be, depends on your perspective as to how important that approach really is, but I mean, it also obviously relates to Massachusetts and liquor and how many opportunities any of us has to access liquor. And then the last one was public records law. A lot of discussion about public records law, a lot of, I think, thankfulness that the legislature has taken a step back from the version that they had in front of them before. I know managers have been very, very concerned about the impact at the local level, and a lot of selectmen who were there were concerned about it as well. And it appears that they are rethinking whatever it is they're going to push forward with. I think the local cost and the potential for anyone to ask every day, almost at will, for public records, and the burden that could place on communities were really the issues, I think. It's not that people don't also agree that the public records law needs to be improved. Anyway, those were the highlights. It was all in Concord. There were actually a fairly good crowd and fairly engaged group, so.
Okay.
Ricky, you were there. I don't know if you had anything else you wanted to say about that.
But not on that topic.
Okay.
But one other subject before we have you adjourn is, I forgot to mention, if anyone needs assistance with presentations for special town meeting, we need to...
You're the lucky guy.
...working on that in the next couple weeks.
Okay.
And this week is very busy. Next week is a little bit more open at the moment.
Okay.
We adjourn.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained?